such a pleasure to be up here in front of all of you. And yes, I've been drinking red wine, which I always do and have done since the beginning of my Reggio days. I want to say a big thank you to Louise and Laura and for my time here as Reggio student and as managing editor of a couple of 12 streets and all the things that came after that. When I started, I thought I knew so much. And the funny thing is, as I kept learning, I realized how much I didn't know. And I still, to this day, as a professor and teaching English 101 and 102, I think back on Seth and all of the hash marks he made on all of our edits and helped us with all our papers. And when I look at my students' papers, a lot of times I'll think to myself, and I'm not even supposed to deal with grammar so much. I'm really supposed to only deal with content, but I think that it's really important. And content too. You taught me so much, and I just want to say how thankful I am. I'm going to read three poems, one that was in 12th Street, one that I wrote during Reggio, and then a new poem. I figured that would kind of work well. So first, a poem I wrote while I was in the Reggio program, and I've read a couple times. This is called In Transit. "You're a beautiful woman," said the drunken construction consultant at Tracks, the Penn Station watering hole, with swivel chairs and sweet bartenders who ease the pain of missing that train by just 1 minute. "Let's keep in touch." He didn't tell me his name or texting his number. "Crazy bug orange full moon. Why don't I live in the city anymore? Suburbs suck passion and bleach marrow. I'm moonstruck." Hey, did you know my biorhythms and Nick Cage's are a 98% match? Someone let him know, please. What? You don't believe in astrology? Blow me. No, really, lonely, lonely, suffering full moon fever from my kitten heels to the hoops on my ears to the glass shards of my iced nipples. Orange is calming and prevails over fast food joints and train stations. So this was in the blue issue of 12th Street. Rebecca Melnick, beautiful Rebecca, who just had a baby boy on the 16th. Let's just give her a little was my poetry editor for this. It's called Another Full Moon Poem. Yes, I have a moving. "What if ownership of feeling belongs solely to the whims of gravitational pull? Stupid moon, you're nothing but a mannequin, a pretty, pearly oyster shell. Lead me round in circles while my doctor writes a paper cure. No matter if it makes me drive in my sleep. No matter if it removes synchronicity. Why place gems in my path? Why sit fat, lighting the night sky, leaving only spikes and bombs buried in the dirt, waiting for the right foot to set them off?" So the moon thing, just real quickly. I'm listening to NPR yesterday on my way back from teaching my class, and so China and India are going to do this whole thing where they're trying to colonize the dark side of the moon, and they found water on the moon, and all I could do last night was like, when I was sitting and talking to my husband, was like, wow, wouldn't it be cool if we could be up there colonizing the moon? They might need professors. No, they're going to need geologists, they're going to need, they're not going to need people like it. I was like, kill my dreams. But I'm still going to write a ton more moon poems, especially knowing that there's all this shit going on in the moon. So I'm working on this new series, and I'm calling it The Princess Manifesto. I'm taking back the Disney princesses and making them strong for today. I have a ton of them, but I'm just going to read one. and I'm still working on them, so again, work in progress. This is Rapunzel. Rapunzel didn't enjoy spinning. The seat was too hard, and her legs kept getting cramps. But it was the only exercise the witch allowed. She didn't like the prince's embrace. His tug on her braid sent her into convulsions. His promise of a kingdom while his hard body pulled and pushed didn't make it hurt any less. How many times must she endure his visits before he gets the freaking guts to take her with him? Does he even have a kingdom? All this thinking while spinning left her raw. Plus, she needed more greens. And while she could look upon the witch's beautiful garden from the tower, all that bitch ever brought her to eat was porridge. She decided to weave a trap and get the hell out of that tower on her own. When the witch came in, Rapunzel's bald head shocked her silent. She used that moment, took the withered old bat by surprise, and wrapped her scrawny neck in a blonde braid noose. Evil witch shook and sputtered. Rapunzel went straight to the garden and ate all the greens she desired. She knew she didn't have much time, though, before the prince returned. In the witch's cabin, she kept watch, lit candles, practiced spells, read by the fire. Then she packed up everything of value in a black leather satchel and took off to find some vipers and get tattooed. Thank you.